जति गोपी जन बल्ल Yeah.
इस्कॉन फाउंडर आचार्य श्रील प्रभुपाद की अनंत कोटि वैष्णव वृंद की प्रेम से कहो सी कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधार श्रीवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद की नामाचार्य श्री हरिदास ठाकुर की श्री प्रभुपाद की प्रभुपाद अनुगा की सामवेत भक्त वृंद की नित्ताई गौर प्रेमानंदे ऑल ग्लोरीज असेंबल्ड डिवोटीज ऑल ग्लोरीज असेंबल्ड डिवोटीज ऑल ग्लोरीज असेंबल्ड डिवोटीज ऑल ग्लोरीज ऑल ग्लोरीज ऑल ग्लोरीज श्री श्री गुरु एन गौरंगा All glories, all glories, all glories to Srila Prabhupada. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नारायणं नमस्कृत्यं नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयमुदीरयेत् नष्टप्रायेषु अभद्रेषु नित्यं भागवत सेवया भगवतीरुत्तमश्लोके भक्तिर्भवति नैष्ठिकी रीडिंग फ्रॉम श्रीमद् भागवतम हूज बुक इज दिस इट्स मार्किंग ऑन द भागवतम राइटिंग ऑन द भागवतम Lord Rishabhadeva's teachings, Canto 5, Chapter 5. Text 18. Gurur nasasyat, swajano nasasyat, pita nasasyat. दैवं न सत्स्यान्न पतिश्च सस्यान् नमोचयेत्यः समुपेत्य मृत्युम् गुरोर्न सस्यात् स्वजनो न सस्यात् पिता न सस्यात् जननी न सस्यात् दैवं न तत्स्यान्न पतिश्च सस्यान् नमोचयेत्यः समुपेत मृत्युम् गुरोर्न सस्यात् स्वजनो न सस्यात् पिता न सस्यात् जननी न सस्यात् दैवं न तत्स्यान्न पतिश्च सस्यान् नमोचयेत्यः समुपेत्य मृत्युम् Open the window. Open the windows. Guruhu, a spiritual master, na, not, sah, he, syat, should become, swajanah, a relative, na, not, sah, such a person, syat, should become, pita, a father, na, not, sah, he, syat, should become, janani, a mother, na, not, sa, she, syat, should become, daivam, the worshipable deity, na, not, tat, that, Syat should become na not patihi a husband cha also sah he syat should become na not mochayet can deliver yah who samupetam mrityum one who is on the path of repeated birth and death. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada Srila Prabhupada Ki. Translation, one who cannot deliver his dependence from the path of repeated birth and death should never become a spiritual master, a father, a husband, a mother, or a worshipable demigod. Purport, there are many spiritual masters, but Rishabhadeva advises that one should not become a spiritual master if he is unable to save his disciple from the path of birth and death. Unless one is a pure devotee of Krishna, he cannot save himself from the path of repeated birth and death. Tyaktva deham punarjanma naiti mameti so Arjuna. One cannot stop birth and death only by returning home back to Godhead. One can stop birth and death only by returning home back to Godhead. However, who can go back to Godhead unless he understands the Supreme Lord in truth? Janma karma chame divyam evam yo veti tatvatah. We have many instances in history illustrating Rishabhadeva's instructions. Shukracharya was rejected by Bali Maharaja due to his inability to save Bali Maharaja from the path of repeated birth and death. Shukracharya was not a pure devotee. He was more or less inclined to fruitive activity and he objected when Bali Maharaj promised to give everything to Lord Vishnu. Actually, one is supposed to give everything to the Lord because everything belongs to the Lord. Consequently, the Supreme Lord advises in Bhagavad Gita, Yat karoshi yad ashnasi yad juhosi dadasi yat Yat tapas yasi kaunteya tat kurushva madharpanam. O son of Kunti, all that you do, all that you eat, all that you offer and give away, as well as all austerities that you may perform, should be done as an offering unto me. This is bhakti. Unless one is devoted, he cannot give everything to the Supreme Lord. unless one can do so, he cannot become a spiritual master, husband, father or mother. Similarly, the wives of the Brahmanas who were performing sacrifices gave up their relatives just to satisfy Krishna. This is an example of a wife rejecting a husband who cannot deliver her from the impending dangers of birth and death. Similarly, Prahlada Maharaja rejected his father and Bharata Maharaja rejected his mother, Janini Nasasyat. The word Daivam indicates a demigod or one who accepts worship from a dependent. Ordinarily, the spiritual master, husband, father, mother or superior relative accepts worship from an inferior relative. But here, Rishabhadeva forbids this. First, the father, spiritual master or husband must be able to release the dependent from repeated birth and death. If he cannot do this, he plunges himself into the ocean of reproachment for his unlawful activities. Everyone should be very responsible and take charge of his dependents. Just as a spiritual master takes charge of his disciple or a father takes charge of his son. All these responsibilities cannot be discharged honestly unless one can save the dependent from repeated birth and death. Om Jnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshur Unmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupakada Mahyam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guruho Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Gurum Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Ragunatan Vitam Tangsajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Zagitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakan Vitamscha Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prishtaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swaminiti Namine Namaste Saraswate Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvisesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Deshatharine Jaya Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabho Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. These are wonderful instructions from Lord Rishabhadeva given to his sons. His eldest son is Bharat Maharaj. And there are 100 sons that he is giving these instructions to. And he is not compromising in telling the truth. Don't be a father if you cannot deliver your sons from the path of birth and death. And he is a father also. He is telling the sons. In other words, he definitely is going to deliver his sons from the path of birth and death by giving them these powerful instructions without any compromise. And if you look at it, it's very bluntly, Nayam deha deha bhaja nirloke kashtan kaman arhati vidbhujam ye tapo divyam putraka yena sattvam shuddayet Brahma Saukhyam Tvanantam. You will see that he is telling, don't be like dogs, hogs, pigs, Vidbhujam, stool eating dog, and don't live like this. Not that they were living like that. He is telling them, and you must perform austerities, you must make use of the human form of life. Very strong instruction. People need instructions. People need to be told the right thing. They may not like it, but that does not matter. If you ask them, they will say, yes, I need these instructions and I don't like it. This is a genuine person. I need it and I don't like to hear it. Dhritarashtra was always telling Vidura, your instructions are so true and so bitter to digest. So most of the time he would call upon Vidura whenever he has a problem and he would come and advise him, don't do this. And he will say, I can't digest what you say, but it is the truth. And he will end up not listening to what Vidura says. The person who does not listen, although he wants good instructions, a brilliant example is Dhritarashtra. On the wall, I know what I am doing is wrong, but somebody please help me. And they are told that you are doing is wrong, but I will do the wrong anyway. I have heard. So he suffers much more. People want instructions. They have to be told. The decision is theirs. Like Dhritarashtra making a decision, and in the end he will suffer it. All his 100 sons will die. And Vidura will come again and tell me, you did not listen to me. You did not follow Dharma properly. Everything was arranged by Krishna for you. I gave you instruction, you had the opportunity, you did not do. Therefore, what is the use of lamenting now? At least now, go to the forest. Develop some detachment. He utilized that situation and again instructed. Here, Vidura is instructing Dhritarashtra. So, you have to give people instructions. They want it. They need it. That's why there should be genuine spiritual masters who give instruction without compromise, without worry about whether it will be accepted or not. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada is such a person. In this world, nobody likes to hear these instructions that you should not enjoy your senses. It should be very controlled. You should dedicate yourself to serving the Supreme Lord. These are all not things people are going to do normally. They want to hear what they want to hear. They want to hear what they want to hear. If you give instruction that they like to hear, then they will like you also. So you have to learn to give instruction to them that benefits them and also they tend to like. This is what is Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada's unique, amazing character and characteristic, is that he was able to deliver these instructions in a manner that it was digested by people of all sorts, not just in India. Not just in India. So it was a very responsible service done by him. So people need instructions. They have to be given according to time, place and circumstances and situations. And those instructions should be followed. One thing is to give instruction. Next thing is they should be followed and executed. If it is not followed and executed, what is the use of an instruction? What's the use of an instruction? So, people who don't follow instructions, they don't inspire the person who is giving the instructions. If you're not interested, they also not be inspired to give you instruction further, especially in Kali Yuga. So, this is a very important thing. It's a responsibility, Prabhupada is saying. Everybody should be very responsible to do this. The father, whether it's a father, mother, it's a king, it's the employer, it's a spiritual master, anybody has got a responsibility. You cannot think in your mind, I'll let him do what he wants to do, I don't care, it's not my problem. It's not my problem, I don't have to worry about it. This is nonsense. That means you are not fit to occupy the position that you are occupying. Invariably, there will be a lot of difficulties. Bhishma, his position was that of a leader. Naturally, he was a leader. Whole family of the Kauravas, the Pandavas, everybody were under him actually. Although Dhritarashtra was the king, everybody sought advice from him, including Dhritarashtra. as an elderly person, very experienced, highly skilled, very materially very qualified, plus spiritually qualified, plus fit to be the king, but is given up kingship, but doing the job of kingship. This type of, oh, you don't have a title anyway, you're not the king, just shut up, I'm not going to listen to you. It's very easy to say that to Bhishma, isn't it? Because he doesn't have the title of a king. But he was executing a responsibility which was so difficult to execute. But he did it to the best of his extent, because he knew, I am responsible. Whether I have a title or not, people come to me and ask me. And I must execute. I am like a guru. I am like the senior most person. I must guide them properly. And if they don't listen, that is even worse. And they had people like that. Dhritarashtra would not listen. Duryodhana will not listen. Many problems, many complications. But he kept on trying to do it. Like that, you have people who don't even have a title as a king or as a father. Like Bhishma, he's not a father, he's not married. I'll not be a king, he took these vows. Still, he executed those roles. He executed the roles. That is very amazing. Because he's a very responsible person. I don't need a title to execute my responsibility. It's not that if you are this thing, I don't know, I am not the temple president, I don't know, I am not your father, I don't know, I am not your husband. If you start answering like that to people who come up to you, then they will be lost. They will be actually lost. So Vedic society is such that everybody executes their roles as king, as father, as mother, as, you know, elder, everybody. And naturally, there is leadership involved, whether you like it or not. And it is so nicely done, naturally done, and I am happy to take that responsibility because of so much of love and connection with Krishna in the center. That is the whole thing about Varnashrama. Krishna is in the center, we are all connected because of Krishna. For the sake of Krishna, I must do. For the sake of proper cultural, religious and other stuff, I must do. And I am a gentleman because I do it. And I am accepted in the community because I do that. So these are all important. That's why Rishabhadeva is saying, don't become guru, don't become this, if you cannot do the job of leading them back to Godhead. In other words, here is the definition. Anybody who claims to be a leader of any sort, he must give advice to them to go back to Godhead. The definition of a leader is one who helps you to go back to Godhead. You will see that today leadership, all being discussed everywhere, is nothing to do with going back to Godhead. It's all about how to exploit nature, how to make money, how to exploit people, how to become rich, how to become powerful, how to influence people and do all these things without actually any benefit to society or to anybody else, but only benefit to you. Only benefit to you. So you have numerous examples. Rishabhadeva stood up and said this, and he was like that. Of course, he is an incarnation of the Lord. And he is like that. He guided his sons very wonderfully. So what is this responsibility? That Prabhupada is saying, if he cannot do this, he plunges himself into the ocean of reproachment for his unlawful activities. Everyone should be very responsible and take charge of his dependence, just as a spiritual master takes charge of his disciple or a father takes charge of his son. All these responsibilities cannot be discharged honestly unless one can save the defendant from the repeated birth and death. So the foundational responsibility you have in leading is to make sure that that person is spiritually oriented. This way you will see all your material things that you want to lead that person into will also be successful. So that's the type of thing that is required in society. Everybody needs help with progressing in life. And a person who gives that doesn't mean that he does not give other types of advice. But if a person who gives other types of advice for material advancement but never gives any of this type of advice for his spiritual advancement, he will not be able to be very successful or make that other person very successful. It may go on for some time, but after some time definitely it will break up. Jai Jagannath Baladev Shubhadramai Ki. So you will see
that all these instances of persons who were great spiritual masters, you should take the example of Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada,
of all different types of people from all over the world, and gave them such valuable information, such great contribution, that is remembered and remembered throughout generations. He will be remembered. He became known because of his very sincere desire to elevate people to Krishna consciousness. Simply only that desire. He automatically doesn't have to be given a leadership role or a title. He title will go behind him. His function, his execution of the responsibility for people of this world was so powerful that the title needs to follow him. It's not that he will hide under a title. I need a title, otherwise how will people follow what I say, is one thing which most people need in this world normally. But to do the job irrespective of a title, and the title follows you. Title follows you. That is the type of responsibility that Prabhupada took. It's not that he's asking for, please call me a spiritual master, please call me guru, please call me acharya or anything like that. He's teaching by example, and people follow. And as they get realizations, they understand this person is amazing. He should be respected. He should be glorified. Look at the contribution he has made to my life and to other people's life. Naturally, this is what is the type of leadership that is explained here. It is not that the father has to tell the son, I am your father here, behave to me properly. Nowadays in Kali Yuga it is like that. The son will tell all sorts of things to the father. He'll do all sorts of things to the mother. More to the father. So bad that the father has to remind him, do you know I am your father? This is not the way to talk to me. Please give me at least respect for the title that I have as a father. This is Kali Yuga. And the father also may have not done some things properly also. One who needs to tell people that I am your so-and-so, you know that, is in a very poor position of leadership. Either he is not respected from this side, or he is not executing what he is supposed to do. So these responsibilities, automatically when you carry out, they make you that person. You don't need a title. That is the way Vedic society is. That is the way Vedic society is. How? Father will execute his responsibility whether you do it or not, whether you care for it or not. I want to do it. It's my responsibility. I must do it. I am very keen. And why? Because sve sve karmanya biratah samsiddhim labate naraha. Each one according to his position, if he executes his responsibility, I will become perfect. I will go back to Godhead. I will get attachment to Krishna. So, in execution of your responsibility, don't think you are alone. You are getting a very great benefit. What is that? You will also progress spiritually. It's all tied up one inside the other. If you sincerely execute your responsibility without looking at the title and asking for a title or anything, you will actually be rewarded by Krishna in this system. You will be rewarded by Krishna because you will be contributing to the whole system working and people going back to Godhead. That's why a king has to be worried about it. He has to be worried about all the praja. He has to be worried whether, that's why you will see Prithu Maharaja's pastimes, you will see he will be asking all the people, please follow Varnashrama. Please execute your duties properly as a mother, as a father, as a guru. You please execute your responsibilities properly, because if you do that, I will benefit. If you don't do that, I will carry 1/6 of your karma on my head. And if the entire praja, 1/6 is enough to kill you for the rest of your existence, if they don't do. So the king is also very worried. He has self-interest also. I must do my responsibility correctly. And if I do it correctly, I will accelerate my spiritual life tremendously. And I should teach all of you right and make you do it, give you all the facility to do it. And if you all do it, I benefit. So don't think responsibility is simply plain responsibility. In the material world today, if I take responsibility, I need some fruitive, tangible result from it. Money. I do some work. It's a very low class way of understanding work. Krishna explains work in various levels in the 3rd chapter, in the 5th chapter, and in the 18th chapter and other places. Work does not mean just I work, you give me money, finish, I'm happy. That's a very low way of understanding work. But that is Shudra. Shudra means I work for money. Kim kara. I'll do something, you give me money. I've done my responsibility. That's not the definition of work. The definition of work really is, I engage you in Krishna's service. That is the best type of work. That's a top level. I teach you how to work for Krishna, how to serve Krishna. That is the best type of work. And that is the best type of teaching. Then down on the lowest level is, you do work, I'll give you money. You do something, I'll give you material benefit. This is the lowest. Between that, there are various ranges. Various ranges. But what here Rishabhadeva is saying, you must make people do this top. Otherwise, you're not fit to occupy your position. It is not that simply because you engage somebody in doing some work and you gave them some money, you have done a great job. It's a very low level. Very low level. So I have interest that if I engage you in Krishna consciousness by giving you good instructions and you progress, I benefit. I benefit also. So serving the Lord benefits everybody. Everybody it benefits, including the Lord. He is also very happy that everybody will come back to Him in Krishna consciousness. So you have to see the very large picture of devotional service. That's why Rishabhadeva is saying, Yajnyartat karmano anyatra lokoyam karma bandhana tadartam karma konteya muktasanga samachara. Very nicely in the 3rd chapter, Krishna is defining what work is. Because he has to convince Arjuna, who has asked questions and he has been answering him. He has to convince him very clearly. And so he defines first, who are you? And since you know who are you and you know your material position in Varnashrama, what you should do? What is your title as a Kshatriya? Therefore, what should you do? And you can never be without doing that Kshatriya title duty. If you do, then you are sinful. Then he goes on to say that you have a constitutional duty. Varnashrama duty is one. You have a constitutional duty. that is to serve the Supreme Absolute Truth. That also you must do. In fact, if you do that, you don't even have to do this one. So you may not be able to do that fully, so at least something you must do. Yajnyartat karmano anyatra. Something for the sake of Vishnu you must do. Start off. In this way he explains. Work means that. It defines work to Arjuna very nicely. And he says, I want you to do that. You do this war fighting yajnyartat karmano anyatra. Without any desire for fruit, as an offering to the Lord, if you do, it's perfect. See, even Krishna very responsibly leads Arjuna into Krishna consciousness. He is executing his responsibility. Why? Because Arjuna said, Sashyaste ham shadi mam tvam prapannam. You become my guru. Not only are you my charioteer, person who drives my chariot, not only are you my friend, you also become my guru. And he plays the role of the guru. When he plays the role of the guru, he does a very 100% perfect job of instructing his disciple. That's a brilliant example of who a guru is. Very patiently on the battlefield, sitting on the chariot as a driver, he is explaining, answering his questions. Such a brilliant conversation. And he's doing that in that position. And then he's asking, did you understand? Have you understood? He's even checking up. Have you understood? Tvaye kagrena chetasa. Have you heard with pinpointed attention? Pranashtaste dhananjaya. Oh, conqueror of wealth, did you do it? Do you understand? And Arjuna is replying, thank you. Tvat prasadat maya achyuta stito asmi gata sandehe karishye vachanam tava. I have understood. Now I am going to do what you say. So, it's an amazing, very wonderful conversation wherein you can see responsibility being executed. Responsibility being executed by Krishna himself, showing what a guru should do. So much concern and so much care he is showing for Arjuna. Every question is answered. Right? So of course in Kali Yuga these things may be challenged to a great extent. We may not always be able to do to such a clear great extent. However, that's the instruction given by Rishabhadeva. Do not be occupying titles and positions. So I remember once while I was speaking about this somewhere in Mayapur, I think I was saying, Gurur Nasasayat can be translated to today, don't become temple president, don't become JBC, don't become guru, don't become, if you cannot, TP Nasasayat, GBC Nasasayat, Guru Nasasayat, don't take up all these positions. If you're not confident of actually executing that. Because nowadays in Kali Yuga, people just want a title to feel comfortable. I am somebody. But it's very shallow. It's a shallow thing. You should become qualified to occupy that position. To use a Shakespearean phrase, like a dwarf in king's clothing. Shakespeare used this. He said that if a dwarf, you put a huge robe of a king on him and a big crown and all those things together, he get drowned in it. All you can see is the title. You can't see the person. Person is not befitting the title. That he gets drowned by the title. And that's what he wants. Everybody should see me in terms of the title I have. So that's what is being mentioned here. Don't use this title, don't occupy that position if you cannot help that person to get back to Godhead. Right? So this is a very powerful instruction. It's about titles, it's about responsibilities, it's about our own capacity to be able to fill up and do the needful. You see? So people think all sorts of things. People sometimes even appropriate the worship and respect meant for somebody else to themselves. People are so hungry and lusty for getting appreciation, getting some recognition for a title that they occupy, even though they have not done what they are supposed to do. Or rather, even though somebody else is supposed to be taking that appreciation, they are willing to swallow it. Like some Prabhupada often is speaking about bogus gurus who stand in between the Lord and that aspirant and promote themselves as God. Why God? I am there for you. They want to take the title, they take the worship of God. They want to occupy the title of God. And you afford everything to me, accord everything to me. Why God? Sometime back on the internet there was this little story about a man who is a coward, you know, something like a, you know, he carves stones, nice statues and all that, vigraha, and he's made one of his beautiful Krishna statues or vigraha, and he's going to sell it. So to take that, he uses a donkey, puts it on top of the donkey, ties it up and takes the donkey, and he has to walk a long way. So he's walking and going, but everywhere he went, everybody was paying obeisances. The donkey who was carrying the deity was thinking in the mind, why is everybody paying obeisances to me? Because it's a donkey, right? So why is everybody paying obeisances to me? In every village, every junction they came, everybody is paying obeisances. And the donkey really thought, paying obeisances to me. And obviously because he was carrying the deity, the person who was herding the donkey along with the owner, he did not actually have to push the donkey much. The donkey was very enthusiastically going ahead because it was getting recognition. So it's actually walking faster also. Wow, everywhere I go to every junction, people bow down. Whatever has happened to me, something has happened to me, maybe I'm radiating something, I've got some tejas around me. What all he must have been thinking. And then finally, we went to the market and the sale occurred, and then no more the vigraha was on top. On his way back, he was thinking, why people are not paying obeisances to me? Why nobody is paying obeisances to me? My gosh, how dare you people commit this offense? So, the obeisances were meant for that deity. But the donkey appropriated it to himself. The title, I want appropriation for the respect that goes towards that title. And therefore I occupy that title. This is what Prabhupada is talking about. Bogus guru who cannot save you from repeated birth and death, but wants to occupy that position. So these are some of the simple realizations we can have from reading this. From text 18 of Canto 5, Chapter 5. Om Tat Sat Srila Prabhupada Ki Granthraj Srimad Bhagavatam Ki Nittai Guru Premanande. Any question or comment? Anybody has any question or comment? Okay. Yeah. Does the leader need to be fully qualified to go back home before he says others to go back home, back to Godhead? Prabhupada has answered that question. Because obviously you may not be qualified, but you can always instruct people to the extent that you are qualified or to the extent that you know. And you can always refer, I am speaking from so-and-so's books, I am speaking according to so-and-so's instructions. I can be a medium for transferring an instruction. It's not that you have to tell people that you ask me this question, I am not qualified to answer this to you, I am very sorry, I will not be able to direct you because I am not pure devotee. That would be a very horrible thing to say. So you could say that I may not be very perfect, but I am following the instructions of a perfect person. This is what he says. It will help you. So you can always say that. This is Prabhupada's own dialogue. In a public place, somebody challenged him, are you liberated? You're speaking about liberation, about mukti and so many things. He asked Prabhupada directly, are you liberated? And Prabhupada became grave, and in a very humble way he tipped his head down a little bit and said, I may not be liberated, but I strictly follow the instructions of a liberated person, therefore I am liberated. Gave a beautiful answer and everybody clapped. He tried to catch him and say, are you liberated? And if he says I am liberated, then he's going to ask some more funny type of challenging questions. Right? So Prabhupada said, assume that I am not liberated. You mean to say I can't give you direction? I am giving you the instructions of a perfectly liberated person. To contrast this, I remember very long back, before I was ready to join the movement and following things, we were in IIT Mumbai, and another devotee told me that in the department they had arranged a big seminar of this, that yoga ashram, what's it called? Divine Life Society, very famous those days. And there was a Swamiji from Trivandrum, he was called Parakum Swami, because he was going by flight to everywhere and teaching yoga all over the world. They called him locally Parakum Swami. So he passed away, and then his followers, somehow were doing, and one of the professors that were involved, so he asked all the students and all the departments to attend. And that Swamiji came to speak. He was speaking, and he was speaking of certain dry stuff about, yoga and liberation and all that, and these boys, they're pretty intelligent people. They were not very happy at all. They were just waiting to go, and they were all dragging their feet, making noise, cracking some jokes. There were no phones that day, otherwise they would have chat and they sent messages across. So you can imagine how it would have been for them. And then they said, the thing stopped, and then he said, any questions? And everybody was waiting. I hope nobody asks any question. We just want to get out of the hall. And then one guy, I think he is definitely from Kerala, he asked a question, are you liberated? Actually in a very sarcastic way. Because you give enough of a headache for us for the past 45 minutes. For all that, I just want to know one, are you liberated? And that man said, yes, I am liberated. That Swamiji said, yes, I am liberated. And immediately this fellow said, I am also liberated. And following him, all the students said, I am also liberated, I am also liberated. They all went out. What a shame. What a complete shame for them. And that guy was hanging, that Swamiji was hanging, what's going on? They are liberated. They just want to get out of the hall. I want to liberate myself from the hall. And they were talking about it in such a cheap way, that everybody is saying, I am liberated, I am liberated. Such an insult. Compare that to what Prabhupada said in public. He said, I may not be liberated. I know that. Which is not exactly true at all. It was very humble. And he said, but don't you dare not listen to me, because I am speaking the words of a liberated person. That I know for sure. it straight went inside everybody. And everybody could see that this is true. I must follow this. Right? So I just want to answer that in that sense. Okay. Om Tat Sat, Hare Krishna, Jai Shri Prabhupada Ki, Grantara Chimad Bhag. One more question, it's gone off. It needs your transcendental thumbprint. Who knows all that? Okay, yeah. Where is that? Maharaj, how should devotees carry himself if he happens to be in the midst of non-devotees? Don't try to be a leader, definitely. If you are amidst non-devotees, definitely don't try to instruct them in a manner of I am holier than thou type of this thing. You try to befriend them. You try to become relevant to them. And that definitely requires some little skill. And become accepted and relevant to them. And then maybe things may become favorable and you can convey some Krishna consciousness to them. Especially if you are interested in conveying it to them. So these are general principles. It differs from place to place in each situation and circumstance. So I can only give you a general answer. In the midst of non-devotees, if you are forced to be there, of course, we don't want to be in that situation. But especially if you are working and they are friends or whatever, don't become a, you know, what do you call, an odd one out in the crowd. And don't show your holier-than-thou attitude to them. Rather, be very strategic and very careful. And at the same time, make sure your Krishna consciousness is intact. You don't take their association and you look after yourself. These are some simple things that you could do. Hare Krishna. Grantaraj Srimad Bhagavatam Ki Nittai Guru Premanand.